greatly blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, greatly blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, greatly blessed, highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, greatly blessed, highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, standing upright on God's good earth, counting my blessings, great things He has done, fighting the good fight with the blessed assurance. Blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, greatly blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God, greatly blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God.
Blind, but now I Good morning, Beavertown Bible Church. Morning, that's good. That's not too bad. You guys half awake, staying up too late watching either the Penn State game or ever maybe at the Uprise Festival, some of us. So it's a glorious morning to be back here to serve the Lord, isn't it? And be able to come to his home. And it's glad for me to be back. So if you're able to stand, please stand for the opening prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for just giving us this opportunity to come here to serve you this morning. You know, Lord, we're so grateful that we can come here and worship you freely, because there's definitely places in this country where you can't. Lord, I ask you to watch over us this morning through our worship service, that, you know, not only do the words we sing or the messages we hear, but we worship you through it. You know, no matter what's going on in our lives right now, outside these doors, that we can find safety in you, that you are in control. Lord, I just, you know, want to thank you so much for our church family and for everyone that's here today to worship you together. That each one of us has an individual part that we need to hold to bring your word to life. And Lord, I just ask you to be with the teachers today, that you help them guide their hearts and help them with their words, that it gives the message that we need to hear. And I pray that we listen to those words, that we accept them with our hearts, and we open our eyes and our souls to those messages, that we actually can move forward and spread your love and your message that we need to out in the world. And Lord, just thank you so much for just everything you've given us and for the safe travels here and our families. And just watch over us throughout this worship service today. In Jesus' name we pray. Our first song, the words will be on your screen. It's going to be Good, Good Father.
Just Good morning. Good to have all of your frowning and smiling faces this morning. Some of you have frowns. If you're here for the very first time, we want to welcome you. Thank you for coming and joining us and visiting with us this morning here. And you should have received a packet of information from the Welcome Center out back or right here in the front whenever you came in. And inside that welcome packet is a guest information card, and we would ask that you'd fill that guest information card out and place it in one of the offering plates, which, by the way, are over here at the exit doors and right back here on the center table. So I'm glad you're here today. Just a few announcements. The first thing is I'll be so glad when Pastor Matt gets back here today that I don't have to do this stuff anymore, this opening stuff here, running around and getting things last minute. Oktoberfest. We are setting up a booth at the Oktoberfest this Friday and Saturday, and we will be giving out, handing out living water, all who are thirsty. And good morning. Back to living water. We'll be handing out living water, and it's just Aquafina water with our labels on it, but we'll be sharing, hopefully having opportunities to plant seeds in the hearts and minds of people who need Christ. And so if you're signed up for that, you're a part of that. There's 22, 23 of you. You should have received your schedule last Saturday, two Saturdays ago. So plan to be there. Be there about 10 or 15 minutes before your shift, if you would be. I appreciate it. Also, and I do not like announcing this, but Pastor Appreciation, having a luncheon here on October the 3rd. It's a covered dish meal right after Sunday school. So mark your calendars if you want to come to that. October the 3rd, Pastor Appreciation covered dish meal. The ladies will be providing the meat, the bulk of it, but just bring a supporting dish for that to share. Also, we'll be having our, listen, we are the meet and greet and eat church. So I'm serious. There's three food things on my list here. The fall fellowship meal is on November the 7th. We didn't have that last year. We didn't have Pastor Appreciation last year either. So a double whammy this year. So fall fellowship meal is on November the 7th. Normally, we have it on Sunday evening at 5. We have a program to follow. We're scratching the Sunday evening thing. We're going to have it right after Sunday school, another covered dish meal. Please plan to be a part of that, November the 7th. And this Tuesday is our senior luncheon. I'm getting hungry. Senior luncheon this Tuesday, 12 noon. I send out nearly 80 letters. 80. And we get 24, 25, 26. Come on out and have a good time. We only keep you here for about an hour and 20 minutes, an hour and a half. And they prepare, Sharon and Tom in the kitchen and their helpers prepare a delicious lunch for us. And we have a good time of laughter. So I hope you'll plan to be a part of that. If you're coming, we appreciate you letting Megan know. Call the office and let them message on how many you're planning to come. Also, the men's group, or men who are willing to help out, October the 16th, we're going to be doing work on the playground out here. I hope you'll come and be a part of that and give a hand on that day. I'm not sure if we're... Are we eating first, Mark? I'm not sure if it's good to eat first. We might want to work first, then eat later. But anyway, 8 o'clock, I'm assuming, right, Mark? 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock for eat first, and then we'll do a little bit of work on the playground. All right. Have a couple cards here this morning. Want to read to you. It says, to Mark in the men's group, even though you didn't have to do it, you did it anyways, and it was much appreciated. Thank you so much for last Saturday's meal. That was last Saturday's meal. The food was fantastic. We know it took a lot of work, and the Joy Group is grateful for the godly men of our church. May our God continue to use your ministry for his glory. Thanks, the Joy Group. So, you can clap. I know he'll probably get embarrassed, but I appreciate Mark. I do. I really appreciate him. The work that he does here. Last Saturday, he got here about an hour late, about 10 o'clock. He got here at 10 in the morning. And he was here till about 8 or 8:30 at night, and he wasn't at the concert. He wasn't over there under the pavilion. He was here working. He was in the kitchen cleaning dishes. I mean, just scrubbing pots and pans. He brought kettles. He is so instrumental to our men's group ministry, and you never see him. I mean, he's back in the sound booth, and he'll open his mouth every now and then back there and say something stupid. But I appreciate him. I do very much so. And the church should appreciate him because he does a lot of work for us. Kevin, I'm sorry I didn't leave any room back there for you, as his head's about three sizes bigger than what it should be. But I got this little card, and I don't remember when was this given to me. I know you when you gave it to me, but when was this supposed to be given? Shut down. Okay, Adair wrote a little card here. It never got mailed. This was a year and a half ago, and she was seven then. And she says this, it was during COVID when the church first shut down. She says, "Pastor Jeff, read this to the church. Flowers, birds, and bees, Jesus made them all. How could he forget us? He could not. Do not yell at him. He will help us through this time. Love, Adair, age 7. Adair, you're a special young lady, and even though you like to run around and run from me and hide from me and a little strange toward me, I still love you and I appreciate you. So, all right, Stacy, my wife Stacy has an announcement to make, and so all eyes off of my grandson. Well, that's the problem. They'll look at him and not listen to you. Hi.
Grandsons this weekend. I don't even know what that is. It is that time again of year again for the hats and gloves for Backyard Ministry. We've been helping them for years and years, and every October they distribute hats and gloves to the children in their ministry groups. We've been fortunate to be involved with their ministry from the beginning, and we've been a kind of a filler. We help with food for the Mount Union area, one neighborhood, but the hats and gloves and then the Christmas gifts have been all over the different areas. Last year we helped in Altoona. This year they have a neighborhood in Pittsburgh that needs some help, and so that's who we will be collecting for this year. Out on the board, there's a slightly beat up little sign because my one grandson carried it in and crumpled it, but it's on the board telling you about it. October the 10th, we'll be collecting, bringing back hats and gloves. There are 120 kids. I already have 25 covered, but there are these little cards. I've done Ziploc baggies in the past, which slide all over the place and make a mess. So this year, just take a card. It has that it's BYM, Backyard Ministry, winter hats and gloves. Please return by October 10th. Take a card, return it with a bag. That can be a Ziploc bag, that can be a grocery bag tied shut, any bag. Put your card in it so I know what size it is, and bring it back by the 10th. And there's everything from extra small child to adult, which just means teen, anybody 13 and over in their program. And they're out on the board. Just take one, buy your hats and gloves, put them in a bag and bring it back. And there's two benches in the hallway. They're storage benches. They open. You can just throw them in there, throw them on top, hand them to me. Anything works. But I thank you very much. That's it. And now I'll get Harvey back.
I had to take him in and rob him with nuts because he was going to cry.
Oh, okay. Isn't he adorable? He is. He is adorable. Before we dismiss our primary and junior church, Connie's going to have a special for us this morning. Connie? Before. Yeah, we don't want them to miss it.
Hold on to me. hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you, when I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me when I forget I need you, when I I'm tired of all my pretending. Hold on to me when I start to break in desperation underneath the weight of expectation. Hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you, when I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me when I forget I need you, when I let go, hold me again.
All right, kids, you can go. They're like, finally. Oh, I'll get that for you, Derek. Thank you. Good morning again. You know, have you ever felt like this or said this or thought this? You know, I need to start eating more healthy. But first, I need to eat all the junk food in my house so it's not there to tempt me anymore. Hey, how come on? You ever thought that? Yeah, I did. I'll start next week when I can eat all the cookies, right? Think about this. A whale swims all day, only consumes fish and water, and is fat. A rabbit only eats vegetables and runs and hops along all day and lives 5 years. Meanwhile, a tortoise doesn't run, does nothing energetic, yet it lives for 450 years. And you tell me to eat well and exercise? I don't think so. Oh, my. All right. Well, folks, we're continuing in our study this morning, continuing in 1 Corinthians, and we're starting chapter 6 today. How many of you have heard this throughout your lifetime as a Christian? You should never... You Christians don't sue other Christians. How many of you heard that? We don't do it. We don't do it. Well, the Bible gives us some instruction with that this morning, and in our attempt not to skip any verses and continue through every book of the Bible. By the way, I'll be dead before we get through all the books of the Bible. Literally, I mean, I'll be gone because there's just no way we could get through the whole Bible in the short amount of time that I have left, at least the next 50 years or so. But the scriptures give us some instruction on that, beginning here in chapter 6. The title of this morning's message is on your screen, was on your screen, and it's called Order in the Church. Order in the Church. How many have heard order in the court? Well, God has designed order within the church, and there are certainly certain things and so that the church is supposed to handle. And Paul is continuing with the idea of church, the church discipline, the church dealing with its own problems. How many of you think today that a lot of the problems that we have would be resolved if the church did what the church was supposed to do? You believe that? I do too. Paul spoke specifically, we looked at it 2 weeks ago, in the last chapter, about a man who was in a particular sin. And because Paul established through the scriptures here for us the church's responsibility, then it's true, that same truth that he has laid out here in the last chapter, chapter 5, is true in the life of any believer in the church who is in a moral compromise. And for their benefit, the church must be what the church is supposed to be. And for the church's benefit, the church needs to be what the church is supposed to be. And now he speaks, Paul speaks about that same representation to the world as we begin chapter 6. And instead of suing other believers, instead of Christians suing other Christians, instead of going to the world for judgment and getting caught up in a worldly court system of the day, the church should be able to settle its differences within her own border. That Christians should not be airing their laundry, their dirty laundry, in public. When you think of, down through the years, some of you will remember some of these names. Jim Baker. Ooh, I heard the ooh. Jimmy Swaggart. Ooh. Ted Haggard. Tony Alamo. Fred Phelps. Doug Phillips. Televangelists. These men, their failures, and the list goes on and on, their failures over the years, so much of that, their failures, their moral failures, has been fodder for our media, hasn't it? It's been fodder for the media. When it would have been wonderful for those things that those men were caught up in to be dealt with by the church. But when there's public recognition and there's public sin, then there's public exposure, and there's a response by the public. The court system in Paul's day was complicated. The Greeks and the Romans, they prided themselves in having their court system top-notch. There were arbitrators, there were public defenders, kind of like there are today in our day. But get this, in the Greek courtrooms, most of the Greek courtrooms of the day, Paul's day, they had 100 jurors. Now, could you imagine that? You know how hard it is to get it right with 12 jurors. Could you imagine coming to a conclusion with 100 people? It was not uncommon in the Roman culture for a son to sue his father. Things haven't changed much. And in our culture today, this was taken in 2003. That was 18 years ago. But in 2003, in America, on average, there were 20 million lawsuits filed every year. Some of the economists said at that time that if our country went through a time like the Great Depression, they said not only would it be an economic crisis, but a legal crisis as well, because so much of our money is tied up in the court systems. Look at the effect on the public health system today with suing and sue happy, insurance for doctors through the roof, OBGYN doctors not practicing any longer, insurance costs. And there are seminars today that lawyers attend on how to sue the church. How to sue the church, because they're slowly running out of organizations that have money to sue. And they're looking at the larger church, the Catholic Church, the bigger denominations. And when they see that, they see dollar signs. They see money figures. You know, we have untapped potential here. We need to delve into this arena. But as a family of believers, we should without going to the public courts, be able to settle things amongst ourselves. And the Bible prescribes a way for that to happen. And because Paul's going to challenge this church because they were dragging each other to the public court system. Look at verse 1 of chapter 6 in 1 Corinthians. And Paul says, "Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust," the unsaved man, "and not before the saints?" So there was another form of church discipline lacking here in Corinthians, in Corinth. And now he's going to ask the church, this is interesting, take notes, write this in your book. He's going to ask the church six questions in this chapter. Six questions. In verse 2, he's going to say, first four words, "Do you not know?" Verse 3, he's going to say, "Know ye not?" Verse 9, he says, "Know ye not?" Verse 15, he says, "Know ye not?" Verse 16, he says, "What? Know ye not?" And verse 19, he says, "What? Know ye not?" Six questions, and he builds his argument around each of those questions. Look at verse 2. "Do you not know? Do you not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters?" Now look here. I got to let you know, I believe in my heart that he's giving a level of sarcasm here. He's being very sarcastic. Verse 1, verse 2. "Dare any of you, having a matter against another brother, go to law before the unsaved man, before the unjust, and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints are going to judge the world? And if they judge the world, if the world shall be judged by you, because you're a saint, that you are unworthy to judge the simplest things, the smallest matters within the church." The saints are going to judge the world. Now, what does that mean? Now, listen. I don't know what that looks like. I want to be clear to you about that. I don't understand what that looks like. But Paul says, if you are going to judge the world, how you can't even take care of small matters within the local church. And just in case you didn't know about the judging of the world, Daniel in chapter 7, verse 22 says this. He says, "Until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the" who? Saints. Saints. That's you and I. "Of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom." And then if you look at in Revelation chapter 2, and you look in Revelation chapter 3, the letters to the churches that were written there, the Bible says in those letters to the churches that you and I are going to rule and reign and shepherd the nations with Christ. Okay? And so the believers will judge the world, and you have to understand what he's saying, because at the end of chapter 5, the last chapter we just read, he says, what do we have to do? Paul says, what do we have to do with judging the world? Because it's God who judges the world. So you have to understand with a difference here. Presently, this is what he's saying, I believe. Presently, it is not your responsibility, and it is not my responsibility. Please listen to this. To pass judgment or to judge unbelievers in the sense of their eternal destiny. That is not our job. God will judge that. God will take care. That's what it says at the end of chapter 5. God will do that. But listen to this. It is up to us. It is up to us. So many people say, I'm not supposed to judge. It is up to us to judge within the body of Christ, within the church. Those things that are right and wrong. It's like we are an accountability group. In chapter 5, look back in chapter 5 and look at verse 12 and verse 13. Paul says, for what have I to do to judge them also that are where? Without, on the outside. Those are non-believers, those outside the church. Do not you judge them that are where? Within the church. But them that are where? Without, God judges. Therefore, put away from among yourselves that wicked person. So, but if a man calls himself a brother in the church, Paul says, we judge that presently. And he said that he judged it. In fact, if you look at verse 3 of chapter 5, and through the first part of verse 5, he says, for I verily, as absent in the body, but present in the spirit, have judged already. Look, I've judged already, because I'm part of the body of Christ, as though I were present concerning him that have done this deed, that man that was in that moral failure. He said, I've judged this already as though I were there concerning him that has done this deed in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that when we are gathered together, look at that. When we are gathered together and my spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ to deliver such a one unto Satan. Paul had already judged this. So we are to judge within the church the things between right and wrong. The church, there's a process for that. Outside the church, unbelievers, we don't judge in terms of their eternal destiny. God judges that. Now, saints are going to judge the world. What does that mean? Well, in the future, when God sets up his kingdom with Christ, and Christ will be governing the world, and you and I will be ruling and reigning under him, we will at that point judge the world, the physical earth. But right now, worldly men are in God's jurisdiction. And then you and I will judge the world. It's interesting. You know, we'll get to judge a city. Maybe you'll get to be a mayor. Maybe you'll get to be a governor. I don't know. I mean, what will we do? I don't know what that looks like. But I can tell you this. When I get to heaven, I was really hoping for rest. I was really hoping for rest. I was hoping to sleep in till noon, sit on the couch, eat bonbons. What are bonbons? Candy. Eat bonbons, right? No, but listen. But then I remember this. New body. Oh. No fatigue. Just a holy zeal and a desire to serve and to see the world filled with his righteousness. It's a different time, different era. Boy, it'll be a delight, folks. And Paul is saying God's going to use you guys to do this. And you can't decide on a small matter within the church. And you know, listen, the shame of it, the shame of it is it's like the Christian yellow pages. What do you mean? Well, some Christians are naive enough just to think that if a person has a fish on the back of their car, a little Christian symbol, a fish, you know, on the back of their car, that somehow they're spiritual. Maybe that fish just means that, you know, my work is going to be a little bit fishy. And you're not going to realize it until after you hire me for a job. Right? Listen, we're talking about suing each other. I would much rather hire an unsaved contractor who does a great job than to hire a nice, wonderful Christian guy who does a terrible job, who gives me something that I have to deal with in my heart because he did a crappy job. I'm telling you the truth. But these kinds of things happen. What do we do? Do we run and sue each other? I hired Ed Runk. Ed in the church. Yeah, he put a doorknob on. He put it upside down. Yep, I'm suing him. Heck, Ed flooded my walk-in closet in my house. I didn't sue him. I'm sorry, Ed. I should have threw you a life vest before I said that. I love him, and I appreciate him. We don't run and sue each other. We don't do that. Hopefully there's enough maturity in us to sit down in arbitration to bring a resolve. And that's what Paul was addressing. We're going to judge the world. Certainly, we can deal with an add-on porch or a water leak. He says here in verse 3, look at this. Know ye not that we shall judge angels? Oh my goodness, as if judging the world wasn't difficult enough. Now we're going to judge angels. How much more things that pertain to this life? Now, it's almost like, for me, it's like he takes it a step higher. You're going to judge angels, and you can't deal with the things in the church? We're going to judge angels. What's that about? Anybody know? Scripture's not real clear on it. And so I don't know. In 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 4, the Bible talks about this kind of thing here a couple places. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. And then in Jude, verse 6 and verse 7, it says, and the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains unto darkness, unto the judgment of the great day, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them, in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal life. But a number of places that tell us that angels are kept in chains until the day of judgment. But it seems to me that God is going to deal with this. This will be God's work at dealing with it, because their destiny has already been determined. Maybe it means, and I don't know, but maybe it means that as we rule and reign with Christ, like he just got done saying about judging the world, we're going to rule and reign with Christ. The angels were created by God. By the way, people are not angels. Please get that right. They're not angels. Angels are created beings by God for his purposes. But the angels were created to be ministering spirits, to minister, the Bible says, to the heirs of salvation. That's you and I. And we're told in Scripture, in Psalm chapter 8, in verse 5, we're told this. For thou hast made him, that's you and I, a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and with honor. In the fall, and I don't want to lose you, because you have to have a handle on Scripture a little bit here, but in the fall of man, and not the fall time of the year, but in the fall of man, we don't appear what we shall be, but when we see him, we shall be like him, the Bible says. But originally, I believe the Scripture teaches us this, originally, human beings in God's original creation were a higher life form than angelic beings. Now, that's hard to believe when you look around this room. Really. And right now, God is working on us. God is conforming and molding and shaping us into the image of his Son. We've not arrived. But in our resurrected form, somehow, once again, we will be clothed in light. Listen, when Adam sinned in the garden, I'm getting off on a rabbit trail. When Adam sinned in the garden, the Bible says he knew what? That he was naked. When Adam sinned in the garden, he knew he was naked. Somehow, the light in Adam went out. It went out. And in the Bible, it says that our bodies will be fashioned like unto his glorious body, and the quote-unquote white light that we are clothed in are his, plural, righteousnesses. His righteousnesses, plural. So the saints will be clothed in the very righteousnesses of Christ. And it seems in that form, higher than the angels, in some form, we are going to be judges in another form of them. And I don't know what that looks like. So the point is, saints are going to judge the world. Saints are going to judge the angels. And you can't even deal with issues that pertain to this life? How are you ever going to judge the afterlife? Now look, I want to be careful here. I don't believe this forbids us to appealing to Caesar. Paul did that. Paul did it. Paul appealed to Caesar. It's not saying that we shouldn't exercise the benefits of the society that we live in, but Paul appealed to Caesar when it was appropriate. And it was the right thing to do. Paul said in Romans chapter 13 and in verse 4, he said this, "For he," the government, the magistrate, "is the minister of God to you for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not his sword in vain. For he is the minister of" who? He is the minister of who? God. "A revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil." I believe there are times when Christians try to settle things with someone else and the other party wants to be nothing but a scoundrel. And they're not going to do what's right. And then you have to come to a point in your life where you say, look, do I let this thing go? You know, there's a higher standard here than this. Should I just let this go? And should I go ahead and just suffer wrong for Christ's sake? Because that's Paul's going to talk about that here just coming up. But I believe, I do, that there are times, Romans 13, 4, that he beareth, that he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of God. And even the believer who is behaving like an unbeliever, they need to come face to face with their actions. And I don't believe that Paul is forbidding that. But that certainly should not be our first course of action. And these Corinthians are just so immature that they are dragging each other to the courts. And there is no way to glorify Christ in the very way that they settle their differences. Verse 4, he says this, "And if you have judgments of things pertaining to this life, set them to judge who are least esteemed in the church." Don't you know that you're going to judge angels? How much more the things that pertain to this life? And if then you have judgments of things pertaining to this life, here's what I want you to do. Set them to judge who are least esteemed in the church. Now, he's being cynical because back in chapter 2, in verse 14, go back there just a minute, chapter 2 and verse 14. Look at what he said. He says, the soulish man, the natural man, cannot understand the things of God, but the spiritual. Look, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them. Why? Because they are spiritually discerned. Look at verse 15. But he that is spiritual, pneumaticos, who is mature, not carnal, mature, judgeth, discerns all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. And what Paul is saying is, you can set those back here in our text in verse 4. He says, if you then have judgments of things pertaining to this life, set them to judge who are least esteemed in the church. He says, you can set those who are least esteemed in the church to judge certain things. He says, I'm going to give you an example. He says, you can take your 10-year-old kid and do that. Listen, when I think about this, I can't believe that the Supreme Court can't figure things out at times. In the name of art and free expression before the Supreme Court, what is pornography? What is not pornography? But I could take a 10-year-old child and I could take a picture, an inappropriate picture, and I could cover up parts of that picture so that I wouldn't pollute the child and say, is that a good picture or is that a bad picture? And that 10-year-old child would know that that's a bad picture. And the Supreme Court can't figure it out, but a 10-year-old child knows. And Paul says here at the end of verse 4, he says, set them to judge who are least esteemed in the church. And he's being cynical to them. Set them over your matters rather than the soulish natural man, the unjust man, the unbeliever who doesn't discern spiritual things. He can't. Set the least esteemed among you. Set them over the things before you take it out to the world. And then verse 5, he says, I speak to your shame. I speak to your shame. And it's funny because the Corinthians were bragging about how wise they were. He says, I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? Because they thought they were the cat's meow. He says, no, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. Is there anyone there that understands that there is a higher standard, that there is a higher law? Verse 6, but brother goeth to law with brother, and that before unbelievers. The Corinthians had a lousy testimony all across the board. They are supposed to be witnesses for Jesus Christ. This is a church that was exercising all kinds of spiritual gifts, but famous for fornication, famous for drunkenness, famous for suing one another. They were divided, and they were a rotten witness. And when you think about this, when I think about this church, this has to do with the way they and the way we choose to live, our character, our integrity. He says, verse 6, but brother goeth to law with brother. And that before, it's done in front of unbelievers. And look at verse 7. Now therefore, there is utterly, look at this, a fault. King James says a fault. I love that, but it means loss. It means loss. There's a loss. Now, therefore, there is utterly a loss among you because you go to law one with another. Why do ye not rather take wrong? You know why? Because we're too full of ourselves and prideful. Why do you not rather take wrong? Why do you not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? What he's saying is this here in this verse. There is a fault. There is a failure. There is a loss. He says, there is already that loss among you when a brother takes another brother to court. Why are you losing? What you're losing is spiritually is more costly than what you could ever lose in the physical. The spiritual is more terrible than the physical loss. And some of these issues, instead of defrauding each other, why not suffer the wrong? Why not just turn the other cheek? Why not just go the extra mile? Why not just bite the bullet? Why not just let it go? Why not just demonstrate the very nature of Christ within you? Listen, because none of us deserve to be forgiven. Do you deserve to be forgiven? No. Do I deserve to be forgiven? God forbid. None of us deserve to go to heaven. It's not about fairness. If we were put on a scale and measured in a court system, you know what would happen? We'd all be damned. Every one of us. You know, I think about Stephen, the martyr. Remember Stephen, who stood before the Sanhedrin and he shared with them everything that they already knew up here, but they hadn't received in here. He shared with them all of the things that they knew already. The Bible says Stephen looked up into the heavens and he saw Christ sitting at the right hand. No, actually he wasn't sitting at the right hand of God. He was standing up. Christ was standing. Every other place in the Bible he sits. He was standing at the right hand of the Father. Stephen looked up into the heaven and saw Jesus standing, waiting for him, just before they stoned him. And as they started to pelt him, to kill him with stones, do you know what he said? He said, Lord, don't lay this to their charge. He didn't say, oh, Lord, please let my lawyer, don't forget to sue them so my family can get all their wealth. He didn't say that. He said, lay this not to their charge. That same spirit that lived in Stephen lives in us. What Stephen faced was not fairness. What he gave was forgiveness. That's Christ's likeness. It's easy to touch. I mean, it's easy to teach. It's hard to live. It is. It's easy to teach. Listen, if I was down there sitting, I'd be crossing my legs one way and crossing them another way because it speaks to me too. It's easy to teach. Oh. But it's so hard to live by. So hard to live by. Verse 6 and 7, he says, but brother goeth the law with brother, and that before the unbelievers. Now, therefore, there is utterly a loss among you. A loss because you go to law with one another. Why do you not rather take the wrong? Why do you not rather suffer yourselves be defrauded? Folks, there's no winner in this. It's not about winning and losing. And then verse 8, he says, nay, no, you do wrong. And defraud, and that your brethren. Your own family. your own family. I know I get you to do this every now and then, but can you just for the sakes of humoring me, could everybody in this section of pews over here just turn your head to the left? And everybody in this section of pew, turn your head to the right. Make eye contact. Go ahead. 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. I know that was hard for you. Now, everybody in this section, I want you to turn your head to the left. Everybody in this section, turn your head to the right. 1, 2, 3, go. Some of you, that was hard. Joyce, I didn't say wave. I said just turn your head. Boy, you can tell who listens around here. Little gee whiz. You're all family. You're all family. And no, you do wrong and defraud, and that your own brethren. I tell those people this all the time. The church is the best dysfunctional family that we have going. It's the best, because every family is dysfunctional, especially mine. You know, I have seen relatively good families, good families, good functioning families do well in their life until grandpa or grandma dies. And they read the will. The next thing you know, they're fighting each other. They stop talking to each other. And to me, it's amazing what a book, what a piece of jewelry, what a car, a painting will do to a family. It's sad. And it happens all the time. All the time. The Apostle Paul tells us this in Philippians. Philippians chapter 2, in the first four verses, he says, "If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, there's any comfort of love, any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels of mercy, fulfill ye my joy, that you be what? Like-minded, having the what? Same love, being of what? One accord, and what? One mind." Verse 3. "Let nothing be done through what? Strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind." Oh, some of us don't like that. "Lowliness of mind, let each esteem what? Others." How? "Better than themselves." In verse 4. "Look not every man unto his own things, but every man also unto the things of" who? "Others." And that doesn't mean you have to be in everybody's business. Look, if you and I would learn to lean and to count on Christ, we could put aside our pettiness, our selfishness, our self-interest, our vanity, our haughtiness, and realize that there is a higher standard. You know, it is never, I was always told this, and listen, I don't always practice this, but I was always told that it's always better to take the high road. How many of you ever heard that? And I also heard that the view is much better from up there. The view is much better up there. There's a higher standard, folks. There's a higher standard. Christians need, if there's a struggle or a difficulty between brothers and sisters, whether it's outside the church, from a roofing project or a mason project or something, you know, or if there's a problem within the church, Christians need to be able to arbitrate, to sit down together and be able to work things out. And Paul says that is the prescribed course of action for Christians, not throwing our insults and hurling our insults and taking people to unbelievers in the world for judgment, when we need to be judging the things within the body of Christ. And if the church did more of that today, I believe the church would be tighter than what it is even. It would be stronger. There's a higher standard, and the life that we live today is one of unity in the Spirit. Folks, the church has a great responsibility. And firstly, it is to be a good witness to the unbelieving world. And part of that requires us to take responsibility for our own. Do you believe that? Yeah. Needs to happen. All right. As Harry Harshbarger used to say, that's all I got for you. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you this morning for those that are with us here. And as we begin to pluck away at chapter 6, I thank you for your word. Lord, for what it means to me and what it means to our brothers and sisters here today. Those that are watching live, it just hit me, Lord, that I did not read the prayer list this morning. And I would ask Derek to bring that prayer list up here this morning as I close out our service in prayer. We will include them. Thank you, Derek. Thanks for speaking to our hearts. And Lord, thanks for prompting me here about this list. This is important. Christians shouldn't be attacking other Christians, suing other Christians, taking them to a godless world for judgment. That's terrible. We need to be settling things amongst ourselves, in-house, and be a light and a good witness to the world around us. Thank you for Paul's challenge to us this morning. And for our prayer list, for Alicia Weibel for travels, for the Bobby Duvall family, for a passing away of Bobby, for Paula Derner for testing, Stacy Hoyt for a procedure on the 30th, for Rick and Linda Grassa for healing, for Bland Parks for testing on Tuesday, for our Oktoberfest, for Ed Anderson, recovery from COVID, for our country, for Anthony Klein for testing, for Curtis Kelly Jr. for MS, for Bonnie Schreiner, for Nancy Contillo, for Dennis Newcomer for COVID on a ventilator, for Anson Hoyt, who's sick this morning, for Charlie Nagel, for healing, and for the Terry Mortar family, as Terry was killed this weekend, 47 years old, and left behind a wife and two kids on his way to work. There's a lot of needs on this list, and I'm sure there's many more that aren't on this list. And the best part of it all, Lord, you're the God of them all. You are. You know their deepest, their deepest, most dire need. You know that. There may be something mentioned on here for someone, and that may not even be the deepest need in their life. It may just be something on the surface. The reality of it is all of us need a relationship with you, every one of us, even those who don't yet know that. Comfort the families that need comforting. Encourage the ones that need encouraged. Strengthen the ones that need strengthened. Bring healing in the lives of those that need healing, whether it's emotional, mental, physical. Be with our country and our military, men and women around the world that fight to protect the freedoms we have in this great nation. Thank you for their sacrifices and their families. And for our missionaries around the globe, spreading the gospel of Christ everywhere we go, everywhere they go. many in difficult ways, difficult situations, many for fear of their life. And here we are, comfy and cozy this morning. Bless them today who are preaching in the rain, who are preaching in the cold, to crowds of people of two and three, just because they want to hear. Thank you for providing for us this morning. Thank you for giving back to us and for allowing us the opportunity to give back to you and to serve with our heart's desire. Speak to all of us today. For someone here who doesn't know Christ, maybe today would be their day, that they would open their heart and say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner, save me. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your promises in your word. We love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Final hymn is going to be Christ the Lord is Risen Today. And the words will be on your screen. Also, just some things that's going on around us, as well as just things I constantly heard over this week. It's one thing. The world is trying to divide us. They're trying to divide us on race. They're trying to divide us on on gender, on beliefs, on, you know, on our godly views. One thing we need to focus, even though we may be citizens of the United States, that's only second order. And we are all citizens of the kingdom of God, and that you are in control, that you do reign, and that we need to stand united together as the body of Christ, that we need to really pull together and be different, that we need to be the light of the world, because there's so much darkness in the world today. You know, it doesn't matter if you look around even just locally or, you know, with stuff in Afghanistan or anywhere in the country. We need Christians. We need God-fearing people who are going to be different, that's going to stand on your principles. So I pray this week that we just do that, that we do it through our workplace, that we do it at home, in school, or wherever you put us this week, that we stand on your, on the Bible and on your principles, that we be your light as you ask us to be. In Jesus' name we pray.